Good morning, everyone. Hey, how great it is to see you all. So great to see you today. Welcome back to people who've been away for a little while. We're just so thrilled to have everyone here this morning. Let's start with a psalm, as we always do. We started reading Psalm 98 last week. Let's finish it off this week. It's such a good one for us. Psalm 98 from verse 4. Listen to this. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King. Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy. Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity. Little remembrance of joy to the world, little remembrance of Christmas in that, isn't there? Well, let's pray before we do anything else. Gracious God, we are all about praise this morning. We celebrate that in the craziness and turbulence of this world, you are a solid rock. In that way, the creation brings glory to you. Let us do the same. May we find encouragement that you are a fair and righteous judge. I pray for our community. Many continue to struggle in the pandemic. Be close to them. Watch over our children. Stand guard over Central Christian Academy, the students and the teachers. Bolster our vulnerable and frail ones. Protect our first responders and give them wisdom and bless them in their sacrifice. Help me now. Let's finish this together. Dear Lord, I need you this morning. Don't let me miss what you have for me in these moments. Calm my anxious heart and mind so that I can be present with you. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, before we get started singing, Julie, did you bring your ram's horn? Because we're just about to unfurl that thing. Okay, before we get started this morning, you know, I wish that I had mentioned last week that I was back from just a week of being away, and it just the opportunity just passed me by, and I was away for my son Dan and his now wife Teresa's wedding in Florida. Missed being here, but was so glad to be there. And as the days pass, I just keep thinking about, you know, 2 weeks ago, I was there doing that. And I was sitting here, and I was enjoying that. And it was just such a pleasure. But I know many of you are praying for me, and Linda, and especially Peter. So important that things go well for Peter. And I think they did. So it's all a blessing. I keep remembering it. It's just a tremendous joy. But thank you. And I just wanted to let you know I'm not overlooking what you did for us in that by just being part of it with us. So thank you so much. Okay, so across the land, stand with me for this great song. The Word of God the Father, before the world began, every star and every planet has been fashioned by your hand. All creation holds together by the power of your voice. Let the skies declare your glory, let the land and seas rejoice. You're the author of salvation, you're the Lord. Across the land. Yet you led the gaze of angels, came to seek and save the lost, and exchange the joy of heaven for the anguish of a cross. With a prayer you fed the hungry, with a word you calmed the sea, yet of silent plea you suffered that the guilty may go free. You're the author of creation, you're the Lord of every man, and your cry of love rings.
ascended into heaven, leading captives in your way. Now you stand before them, interceding for your Lord. From each tribe and tongue and nation, you are leading sinners home. You're the author of salvation. You're the Lord of every man. And your cry of love rings out across the land. You're the author of creation. You're the Lord of every man. And your cry of love rings out across the land.
Amen. That's right. Keep standing for one more song. One thing remains, your love never fails.
Higher than the mountains that I face, stronger than the power of the grave, constant in the trial and the change.
Remains your love.
purify my heart.
Purify my heart. Let me be as gold and precious silver. Purify my heart. Let me be as gold.
Close this part of our service with Let Your Kingdom Come. Such a great song for us. We started learning it last week. Let's go a little further with it today. We'll review it together. And as I just look out, let me just mention this. Some of you have been here a long time. You've heard me say this before. I know we sing some songs that are maybe just not familiar to everybody. But we're learning great songs. We ask God to just bring the best things to us. So I think this is a good one for us right now. Let Your Kingdom Come. If this is a new song for you, just hang in while we just learn them together, and we'll just enjoy singing them, and they'll just keep showing up. They're just going to keep being part of our First Baptist Church songbook. So Let Your Kingdom Come. If it's new for you, just hang with us while we sing it together.
Glorious cause, O God, engages our hearts. May Jesus Christ be known wherever we are. We ask not for ourselves, for your renown. The cross has saved us, so we pray. Your kingdom come, let your will be done, so that everyone might know your name. Let your song be heard everywhere on earth, till your sovereign work on earth is done. Let your kingdom
give us strength.
Give us your strength, O God, and courage to speak. Perform your wondrous deeds through those who are weak. Lord, use us as you want, whatever the test. By grace we'll preach your gospel till our dying breath. Let your kingdom come, let your will be done, so that everyone might know your name. Let your song be heard. Kingdom come.
And God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. It's so good to see you here this morning. I see some faces I haven't seen in a while. I see some guests with us too. Welcome to First Baptist Church. I'm Pastor Mark Massaro, and I am so glad that you're here worshiping with us this morning. It's great to hear your voices. It's good to sing and sit in the midst of you. I'm just enjoying all of that, and I'm enjoying not preaching this morning. We have a special guest with us, Greg Frank from Bethany Camp, so I was able to catch up on all kinds of things this week, but I'm glad to be here with you. Take out your bulletin if you would. I want to just hit a couple of announcements. There are details in here. There are all kinds of things on the website. There's a calendar there. There's a welcome center out in the lobby, so you can't say I didn't know about these things. But just in case, we're really glad you're here. If you're here for the very first time, or if you're watching for the first time online, you can, well, if you're online, you can't fill this out. That would be a little bit hard. But if you're online, you can text Dunkirk to the number 74121, and that will bring you to our welcome card. If you're here physically, you can also scan that or text it, or you can fill out this card. Let us know that you are here with us, and we have a gift for you waiting at the Welcome Center. So we would love to know that you were here with us today. If you are watching online, you can use our digital bulletin, and that will have all of the announcements as well as the sermon slides and notes, so you can follow along with that at faithlife.com/Dunkirk Baptist. If you're here with us in the room and you want to take notes, you can find sermon notes in your bulletin, and you can fill that in as you go along. The March calendar is here. I can't believe March is here in just 2 days. Who's excited about March?
I am.
Who's excited about March Madness? Who's excited about St. Patrick's Day? Even more hands. All right. Good things happening in March. Make sure you pick up a calendar. Put that somewhere where you can see it and remember all the good things happening here. We want you here for all of them if you can make it. Sunday school is right after the service. We have coffee available downstairs, and in the kids' classes, they have snacks available as well. We have classes from the nursery all the way through adults, so be sure to look in your bulletin. It'll tell you where to find those classes, and if you're wondering which one is good for you, stop by the Welcome Center, and Sarah would be happy to tell you. We have growth groups tonight, and throughout the week. This evening is the Massaro Growth Group at Eliana's home right here in Dunkirk. So be willing to come on out, enjoy some food and fellowship and discussion and prayer. We'd love to have you. And then there are growth groups on Tuesday night and throughout the week, as you'll see in the bulletin. Keep me moving, John. There's a men's breakfast on Tuesday morning at Central Station, 8 a.m. All men are welcome. Wednesday night, there's prayer meeting here at the church. We meet down in the fellowship hall. And if you are not on our prayer email, that would tell you about prayer requests within the church family throughout the week. You can also download that prayer request sheet from our Facebook page, or you'd get it through that email. And we love to have you praying throughout the week for your church family, through our missionaries, for our country, for our world. Offering is available for you to give. It's a part of your worship, is to give back to God. So there are blue boxes, one downstairs in the fellowship hall. There's one here in the back hallway. And you can also give online through PayPal and FaithLife. Our missions highlight for the month of February has been Bethany Camp. And as I mentioned before, we're excited to have the executive director, Greg Frank, here with us to give us a live update about Bethany Camp. We've been praying for you and your ministry all through the month. So come on up, Greg. I'm going to say a word of prayer, and then Greg is going to give us a update on the camp. Please bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for your love for us. Thank you that your love never gives up on us. Thank you that your Son, Jesus Christ, was willing to go to the cross and die for us. And I thank you that we could lift up his name in praise this morning. Lord, I pray that everything we do this morning would bring honor and glory to your name. Lord, I pray for those in our church family who are ill, those that are in the hospital. Just give them strength. Pray that they would be able to return to worship with us soon. Lord, I pray for the nation of Ukraine, especially for the believers that are there, that their lights would shine brightly in this difficult time. I pray, Lord, that you would help them to share the gospel. And I just pray that the world would come around that nation and protect them. Lord, I thank you for Bethany Camp, for the ministry they've had to our church family and to our surrounding area for so many years. I thank you, Lord, that things are looking good for this summer in terms of a full camp schedule. I pray for the last 2 weeks of winter camp that they would go well and that your word would be instilled in the hearts of families and of young men and women especially. Let their lives be changed. Let them come to know you as Savior. I pray for all of the needs of the camp, for staffing and for a program director, for all the things that will help their ministries continue well. And I just pray, Lord, all of these things in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. Greg.
Well, it's a privilege to be here with you folk again. I think it was right about a year ago that I was here. And the last couple of years have been unique. For anyone else or just me? It literally is exactly 2 years to the date when COVID kind of started affecting us as a camp, the 1st of March of 2020. We were shut down for 18 months with the ability to host kids overnight. And when I was here last year, we were talking about summer camp with excitement and what was going to happen and everything that was going to take place. And after that, the state of New York rolled out all of the rules that were going to take place for camp in order to make it happen. And to make a very long story short, we were about ready to cancel camp because of everything that was going to happen. And within the period of about 3 weeks, things went here and there and everywhere and so forth. And it was one of the most difficult 4 weeks of camp since I've been there. But all that to say, God blessed us immensely. We were able to go ahead and move forward with camp. And we had a great number of kids come despite the chaos that ensued trying to get them all registered and everything that took place. And we had just about the normal amount of kids that we had, that we normally have, and about between family campers and kids camp, a little over 950 that were there for the summer. And so it was an amazing time. Saw some really awesome things take place in the lives of students especially. Saw a lot of what we would expect with kids just really suffering from the lack of being able to be in community and some discouragement with mental health issues and so forth. All those things exist, and I think will continue on for a while. But I would just appreciate your prayers in that regard as we anticipate what will happen this summer as well with kids being there at camp. Don't anticipate at this point that there's going to be some of those same challenges leading up to this summer, Lord willing, but we're going from there. So after the summer, we normally have a really busy fall season. And that consists of multiple groups of both families and teens that come out to camp with different groups and so forth. We had the largest fall in the history of Bethany Camp. We hosted over 1,500 people from the time that summer camp ended and Thanksgiving took place. And I want to tell you that between summer camp and the fall retreats, we saw over 50 young people come to know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. And that's what it's about. And then beyond that, you see so many discipleship avenues that take place, both from growth and encouragement. And just like this morning, I don't know that third song we sang. What was the name of that one? That was
Refiner's Fire.
Refiner's Fire. Did you catch the words of that? And sometimes we sing songs and we just kind of sing them. I don't know about you, but that kind of just pushed button in me where I'm at and just discerning that holiness. You ever think much time about what holiness really is? The true purity of what God, who God is? And anyways, those are the same types of challenges that we want to present to young people as they come to camp to just grow in their faith, if they know Jesus Christ, their Savior, to really be diving into God's Word and finding people to surround them, to push their buttons a little bit and encourage them to grow. So those are some exciting things that have happened. Our winter season is a little bit slower than normal. Normally winter, we host around 1,000 people in the wintertime between Christmas and about now. We did lose some groups this winter to COVID issues with the revival of the whatever the latest trend of things. I kind of lose track after a while. But we did lose some groups, but God has blessed us immensely. And last year I was able to report that, you know, financially people have given in ways that are just so humbling and enable the ministry to keep moving forward. But with all the things that have happened, we are in an amazing position. And we've been working on a new cabin. If, for those of you to know a little bit of the history, for about 10 years, we've been working at replacing all of the sleeping facilities at camp. They were old and tired, many of them, and the Prianos who came all the way from Pittsburgh this morning just to hear me talk. Or maybe there was another reason, I don't know. Anyways, they've been staying in one of those old, tired cabins, and we are building another new cabin. It will be the last of the sleeping new and replacing all of the old. And it's been a long process, one that is maybe tired us out some, but it's exciting to kind of be on the back end of that. But beyond that, we've been for years talking about adding some indoor recreation space. At camp's supposed to be a place that is outdoors, right? And in the summertime, that's primarily what it is. But some of you that have recognized, you've lived here a long time, sometimes it does something in the summer that makes it challenging to be outside. It rains. This last summer was one of those summers, right? It's pretty wet. It rains and rains and rains. And you run out of places. We have 200 people at camp, and there's only so many places to be. It gets old and tired and smelly, especially at kids' camp and so forth. So we're looking to actually break ground on a recreation building this fall. And we actually have around $130,000 in hand that has been given through different various means. And that's just an amazing thing, given all of the things that have taken place in the last couple of years. So we're really grateful for that. Pray for wisdom as we seek out exactly how to make this work and move forward. We've been working on the plans for some of those things in the last couple of weeks. So God's doing some amazing things in spite of us. And one last thing I want to mention is that as a staff, we've gone through some transition through all of the COVID things that have happened. We did just recently hire a new program director, and his wife will also be on staff, Zach and Kayla Gifford. And we're excited to have them come on board. They're going to be joining us at the end of the school year. They teach in Ohio, and so we've allowed them to finish there, and they're going to join us, our staff, right after Memorial Day. And so we're excited about that. I'm especially excited about that. Take some of the things off of my plate, and we're looking forward to what God will do through them. So be praying for them as they transition and for our entire staff as we work together. So all that to say, I can say all those things really fast because that's how I talk, but we're going to show just a one-minute video here, and it's going to help you because looking right outside the back doors right here, we have snow. You guys don't have a lot of snow here. We probably have a foot to 15 inches still up on the hill, and which is great for snow camp. We've got families there right now enjoying all the snow. I'm looking forward to spring. March for me means hopefully some grass somewhere, even if I have to drive up here to see it. I'm going to see some grass somewhere. But you'll see in the video all kinds of fun things in the summer, and that will be the end of the camp promo, and then we can go from there. Thank you.
Strapped down, persecuted, under pressure, man, that's how we do it. We at war. We at war, but have you even looked at the scoreboard? Scoreboard, scoreboard, W's all day, what you scared for? Scared for, scared for, ain't nothing coming at us that we ain't prepared for. Undefeated, there's no stopping us. Undefeated,
If you'd please stand to read and follow along with our scripture reading this morning. Our scripture reading is 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. And I can't see way back. Page 908 and 1147 in the Pew Bibles. And let's read. So we do not lose heart. You can read along with me.
Should we read together?
Please, let's read together. One, two, three. So we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. As we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are not seen are eternal. Praise the Lord for his word.
Before you go to Children's Church, we have just one thing that we need to do, and we need to recognize that I need your help in singing Happy Birthday to Jamie Gustafson, but I don't see Jamie here. Is she here? Jamie is right there. Okay, this is so great. Yeah, so, are you ready?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Gustafson, happy birthday.
Jamie, how old are you today? 44. 44 has great potential. Good. All right, kids, off to Children's Church with you if you're going. God bless you, Jamie.
Good sound, isn't it? In case you didn't know, we do have kids' church every Sunday. That is for, I think, kindergarten through fourth grade. Does that sound right? Anyone want to? Through fifth? Fourth. Kindergarten through fourth. Great. So they're welcome to go, but you're also welcome to stay here. So I'm excited. We've already heard an update on camp, watched a great video. Doesn't that look like fun? Adults, do you want to go back to camp?
Yes.
There are opportunities for you to go to camp, too. It's not just for kids, but I just want to let families know that if your kids here at First Baptist are interested in going camp, we do have a scholarship fund, and if you need some assistance, we want to make sure that your kids can be there. So come talk to me or contact the church office about that. We want you to get registered as soon as the information is available. Is it on the website? Registration is open. That's great. So there's no excuses. Lock in the dates that you want to go, and we will look forward to seeing lots of our kids go and be excited about their walk with Christ. So again, I have the privilege of introducing Greg Frank. Come on up, Greg. He's going to share God's word with us this morning, challenge your hearts, and he will also, after the service, be with our middle school and high school students for the Sunday school hour, just telling them a little bit more about how they can be involved in camp and getting them excited about that. So thank you. Welcome, Greg.
Thank you.
God bless you.
Thanks.
That's good to be here with you again. Oh, look at it. I'm hot. Last year when I was here, I shared with you a message from the book of Job. Anybody remember? Wow, that's impressive. A whole year later, I can hardly remember what I did yesterday half the time. But we're going to have a bit of a similar message today. It's hard sometimes when you go around and you share different things, because it's not like we could walk through a whole book of the Bible or whatever. I mean, we could do that, but we'd probably have to skip Sunday school and maybe lunch and so forth. But and most of us want to do that. But so oftentimes I end up centering around some of my favorite accounts in Scripture, some things that encourage or challenge me in my walk. And so today we're going to actually be looking at what I like to call these four guys in Scripture. It's not like five guys down the street where you can get a hamburger. There's four guys, and I think most of you are probably familiar with these guys, and especially one of them and specifically. But we're going to be looking at the life of Daniel and his three friends, and probably most of you are familiar with those guys. Daniel's one of the easier, quote-unquote, accounts in Scripture to tell because it almost sounds maybe too hard to believe. And I like to remind myself and everyone else, I truly believe that these are accounts of real people that walk the face of this earth. And I think that's important for us when we interact with some of the things that happened in their lives, because sometimes their circumstances seem maybe a little unrealistic. But he's one of the examples of several people in Scripture that are those that faced hardship. And so I want to just before we start, and I think this is on. Oh, now it is. Kids Church. Did I do something wrong? Rather go the other way? Who might point at? Maybe help me. Ah, perfect. All right. So anyways, some people in Scripture that face some hardships, just real quickly, there's Abraham. Abraham was asked to sacrifice his son Isaac. This one example, multiple times in Scripture, he was faced with very difficult circumstances. We have Moses, and he was dealing with the Pharaoh. And leading the people who didn't always want to go places. I have learned this in life, that you can get kids to do lots of things. Getting adults to go and do things is a challenge at times. But Moses had some very difficult circumstances, many of them. We had Job, who we discussed last time that I was here, and that's an incredible account in Scripture that we can learn a lot from. We had Joseph, also one of my favorite characters in Scripture, who was just so incredibly patient through the difficult circumstances that he faced, many of them seemingly extremely unfair, and yet he continued to trust God. And then we have Paul. Just recently in my own study, I've been walking through the life of Paul and the different things that took place in his life, and he was an amazing individual who just really chose to still share the hope of Christ despite the things that he went through. But this morning we're going to talk about Daniel. I want to just give a few things about the book of Daniel before we start. It's largely held to be written by Daniel. There's some that would refute that, but I would believe that it was written by Daniel. It contains an unbelievable amount of prophecy, and we're going to actually see a little bit of that take place in what we're going to look at this morning. And the only parts of the prophecy that are not fulfilled are what's still yet to come in the end times. And we have other prophecy in Scripture that talks about that as well. There is a little bit of argument about the date of the writing and the authenticity because of the fact that some of those prophecies were so, so distinct and very specific. But I fully believe that it was certainly written by Daniel, and it was for not only the Israelites to learn, but for us even all these years later. But here's some other things. It talks about the beginning part of it, the Israelites being captured. So before we move on, we're going to actually begin reading. And we're not going to read through the entire book by any means, but we're going to do a little bit of reading. So starting in chapter 1, verse 1, let's pick up the narrative that takes place there. In the third year, in the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord delivered Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, along with some of the articles from the temple of God. These he carried off to the temple of his God in Babylonia and put the treasure house of his God. So we need to get a little bit of the background of what's taking place here. Most of us recognize that the Israelites had multiple kings, and we had the split kingdom, and the king of Israel had already been taken over, and the king of the kingdom of Judah was not. And so this is when that takes place, and they were captured, and solely because they were disobedient, right? For many, many years, they had chosen not to follow the Lord. And so because of that, God took them into captivity. And so this is the account of that taking place. Then in verse 3, then the king ordered Ashpenaz, chief of his court officials to bring in some of the Israelites from the royal family and nobility, young men without any physical defect, handsome, showing aptitude for every kind of learning, well-informed, quick to understand, and qualified to serve in the king's palace. He was to teach them the language and literature of the Babylonians. The king assigned them daily amount of food and wine from the king's table, and they were to be trained for 3 years, and after that they were to enter the king's service. Now, not only in Bible times, but oftentimes when countries take over other countries, one of the things that they do is they'll try to indoctrinate some of the young leaders of that group into their culture. And the reason they do that is that they feel like if you were to get them to do that, they're less likely to want to then rebel and go back, right? And so that was what was taking place in this particular situation. The leaders wanted to take some of the biggest and the best and the brightest and to kind of try to indoctrinate them into the Babylonian thought process in hopes that then they would be leaders and so forth and convince their own people to want to stay. So in verse 6, it picks up. Among those were some from Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. The chief official gave them new names, to Daniel, the name Belteshazzar, to Hananiah, Shadrach, and to Mishael, Meshach, and to Azariah, Abednego. But Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine, and he asked the chief officials for permission not to defile himself in this way. Now God had caused the official to show favor and sympathy to Daniel, but the officials told Daniel, "I am afraid of my lord the king, who has assigned your food and drink. Why should he see you looking worse than the other men your age? The king would then have my head because of you." Daniel then said to the guard whom the chief official had appointed over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, "Please test your servants for 10 days. Give us nothing but vegetables to eat and water to drink. Then compare our appearance with that of the young men who eat royal food and treat your servants in accordance with what you see." So he agreed to this and tested them for 10 days. Now I have to say, reading through this, they'd enjoy sitting over here and know me pretty well. I would never volunteer to eat only vegetables. That would not happen for me. I would take the steak and all that kind of stuff, right? But we know that they're doing this for a reason, right? God had told them what it was that he wanted them to do. And for them, this would be a violation of what they were supposedly supposed to do, or they were supposed to be doing in honoring the Lord. And so that was why they chose not to do this, is because for them, it would have been something that would have been violating God's principles. And so we see how God honored that. We pick it up, verse 15. It says, "In the end of 10 days, they looked healthier and better nourished than any of the other young men who ate the royal food. So the guard took away their choice food and the wine that they were to drink and gave them vegetables instead. To these four young men, God gave knowledge and understanding of all the kinds of literature and learning, and Daniel could understand visions and dreams of all kinds." So we see the first step of what took place there when they were obedient to God as opposed to being obedient to the authorities that were there. And I think I skipped over a couple of things here, but I want to go back to. They were considered the young leaders, as I mentioned. They were a group that were being trained to be leaders. But three times, Daniel and his buddies faced decrees that violated God's principles or God's directions. This was the first, eating the food. We're going to come to the next one after a little bit here. So let's proceed forward with the story. We're going to actually move where am I here? All right. Verse 18. "At the end of the time set by the king to bring them in, the officials presented them to Nebuchadnezzar. The king talked to them, and he found none equal to Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah. So they entered the king's service in every matter of wisdom and understanding about the king questioned them. He found them 10 times better than all the magicians and enchanters in his whole kingdom. And Daniel remained there until the first year of King Cyrus." Now, the next step of the account that takes place is we have King Nebuchadnezzar. He has a dream. Now, I have dreams sometimes. Anybody else have dreams? Most of mine have no value. But in Bible times, oftentimes God spoke to people through their dreams. Okay? Most of mine are really strange, make no sense, and they have no value. But in those days, that did. And so Nebuchadnezzar had this dream, and he couldn't understand it. It scared him. And so what would happen is that the kings would bring in all of these enchanters and magicians and so forth, and they would want them to tell them what the dream was. We're not going to read through the whole section of this that takes place, but what took place in this particular situation, he had this dream, and it scared him, and he brought all these people in, but he knew that he didn't want these people to tell him and just make up something. In fact, it was so much so that he asked them, not only do you have to be able to interpret the dream, but you have to be able to tell me what the dream was. And what do you think the reaction of his enchanters was? Wait a minute, I can't do that. We can't figure that out. I can't know that on my own. That's impossible. And he was very angry with them, and he kept going back and forth. And so then he decided, just like most good kings would do, well, if you can't give me the answers that I want, then off with your head, right? That was basically the premise that was going to happen. So we're going to pick up this account in verse 14. When Arioch, the commander of the king's guard, had gone out to put to death the wise men of Babylon, Daniel spoke to him with wisdom and tact. He asked the king's officer, why did the king issue such a harsh decree? Arioch then explained the matter to Daniel. At this, Daniel went into the king and asked him for time so that he might interpret the dream for him. Then Daniel returned to his house and explained the matter to his friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. He urged them to plead for mercy from God, from the God of heaven, concerning this mystery, so that he and his friends might not be executed with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. During the night, the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a vision. Then Daniel praised God, praised the God of heaven, and said, and then he went on to have this prayer that we're not going to read the whole prayer. It's interesting that Daniel, any time that he was faced with something, what did he do? He prayed, right? What a great challenge to us. We're pretty good at praying for the big things. True? You know, if we have really bad health issues or other things are going on, we're happy to pray for those things. But how many of us are in that mindset or mode that we pray for all the little things that take place, right? When was the last time you can't find your keys? You're out the door, you can't find them. Or for some of you kids, your homework is lost and you can't figure out where it is. Or those little simple things like that. Do we go to God and interact with him and ask him for direction? I think that needs to be a part of who we are. So we're going to scoop forward in this the account a little bit further. And we're going to go down to verse 24. Then Daniel went to Arioch, whom the king had appointed to execute the wise men of Babylon, and he said to them, do not execute the wise men of Babylon. Take me to the king, and I will interpret his dream, or this his dream for him. Arioch took Daniel to the king at once and said, I have found a man among the exiles from Judah who can tell the king what his dream means. The king asked Daniel, also called Belteshazzar, are you able to tell me what I saw in my dream and interpret it? Listen to this response. It's really important. Daniel replied, no wise men, enchanter, magician, or diviner can explain to the king the mystery he has asked about. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries, and he has shown King Nebuchadnezzar what will happen in the days to come. Your dream and the visions that pass through your mind are as you lay on your bed are these. And then he goes on to explain this whole long thing of what's going to take place over the next many years in these countries, right? And there's going to be the four kingdoms, and he talks about that, and Nebuchadnezzar is going to be the greatest, or the one, the head, and then we have the feet and so forth, and you guys are probably familiar with that. If not, go ahead. I encourage you to go home and read about that, because not only did this take place in this dream, but it took place in real life, right? It was God giving the reality of what was going to happen moving forward. But we're going to pick up there in verse 45, actually partway through 45, in the second half of it, it says, the great God has shown the king what will take place in the future. The dream is true and the interpretation is trustworthy. Then King Nebuchadnezzar fell prostrate before Daniel, paid him honor and ordered that the offspring and incense that be presented to him. The king said to Daniel, surely your God is the God of gods and the Lord of kings and a revealer of mysteries, for you are able to reveal this mystery. Then the king placed Daniel in a high position and lavished many gifts on him, and he made him ruler over the entire province of Babylon and placed him in charge of all its wise men. Moreover, at Daniel's request, the king appointed Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego administrators over the whole province of Babylon, and Daniel himself remained in the royal court. So a great victory took place, right? And these three men were saved, or four men were saved, the three guys and Daniel. And so that's awesome. But that wasn't the whole story, right? It continues on. It wasn't much longer after that King Nebuchadnezzar actually lived out the dream, right? If I'm going to be great, I might as well be incredibly great. And so what did he do? He built an image 90 feet tall of himself. Sounds like what a good leader would do, right? Here I am great, look at me. And so he builds this great image, and not only does he build it, but then he creates this thought process that now everyone must acknowledge how great I am, and what were they supposed to do? They're all supposed to come and worship and bow down before this great statue. Well, most of the people did that, but we know as the story goes along that we have three guys who did not do that, right? There's a couple little sidelights that I want to just go by. Some of the rest of you, when you read through this book, get confused with the names, right? And Daniel keeps the one name, and we don't hear Belteshazzar very often, but the other three guys, we know them as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and not their other names. I don't know why that's the case, but that hits me sometimes. The other thing is that Daniel doesn't seem to be included in this next section. He's not involved. I'm not sure why that was the case as well. But I want to jump forward in the account because of our time here. And we know that the three guys didn't bow down, but this is where I really want to spend the rest of our time just kind of concentrating on because of what takes in this place in this section. So in chapter 3, verse 16, it says this, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to the king, and this is after they were told that if they don't bow down, then they're going to be put to death and so forth. O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it, and he will rescue us from your hand, O king. But even if he does not, we want you to know, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold that you have set up. That's pretty powerful, isn't it? What a statement. Because they weren't saying, we know God is going to save us from this. We know that he can. We know that he could choose to do so. And he might do that. But even if he doesn't, we're still going to choose to put what we know to be the true God ahead of your gods. What a great, incredible statement that is. How does that play out in our lives? How does that look for us? Each one of us has multiple moments in our lives where we have to choose who we're going to follow. Some of you have heard me talk about this before. There's a song that was put out not too long ago. It's been several years ago now, by a group called Mercy Me. I don't know if you know the story of the lead singer of this group. His name is Bart Millard, I think his name is. And he has a son that has juvenile diabetes. And so this song was written out of reaction to a period of time when they were having gone back to the doctor and been told again for the multiple times that nothing has changed. And I think at the time they talked about this, that this song was written, there had over been 30,000 injections. He has to have an injection every time he eats. And this son now is in his 20s. I don't know exactly the age. But basically, it was a struggle for Bart because he goes out and he tells everybody about Jesus and how exciting it is and so forth, and yet this internal struggle of frustration of going on with this health issue. And so he wrote this song, and I'm just going to read the words to this. I can't read it from there, so I got to hear. They say sometimes you win some and sometimes you lose some, and right now, I'm losing bad. I've stood on this stage night after night reminding the broken it will be all right, but right now, I just can't. It's easy to sing when there's nothing to bring me down, but what will I say when I'm held to the flame like I am right now? I know you're able and I know you can save to the fire with your mighty hand, but even if you don't, my hope is in you alone. They say it only takes a little faith to move a mountain. Well, good thing, because a little faith is all I have right now. But God, when you choose to leave mountains unmovable, oh, give me the strength to be able to sing, it is well with my soul. I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my hope is you in you alone. I know the sorrow and I know the hurt would all go away if you just say the word. But even if you don't, my hope is in you alone. You've been faithful. You've been good all of my days. Jesus, I will cling to you come what may, because I know you're able and I know you can. I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand, but even if you don't, my hope is in you alone. I know the sorrow and I know the hurt would all go away if you just say the word, but even if you don't, my hope is in you alone. And then it finishes out with the very famous hymn, "It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul." Now, I don't know your circumstances today or what's going on in your life. Maybe things are going well. Praise the Lord, right? Maybe there are some challenges that you're facing that are difficult. And there are most likely not these challenges like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego faced. But there are several sides to it. I mean, there's the whole aspect of this is that sometimes the challenge is just our faith being solid and making sure we're focused on who God is and not the other gods that surround us, right? The other things, the distractions that we have that take place in our lives. Because it's easy for us to have those other things distract us from the true God. So maybe that's the battle that you're facing. Maybe it's circumstances like Bart or some others with health issues that are insurmountable. We look around in our world and we see all kinds of hurt. We mentioned Ukraine, and there's many, many, many believers in the country of Ukraine that are potentially going to suffer greatly with what's going on over there. But what will we do? What are we going to do in reaction to that? And so I wrote down some takeaways because I think anytime we interact with Scripture, it's important for us to remember that we leave changed or focused on what it is that we're going to do and how we're going to live. And so number one is this. We need to do what's right according to God's word and despite our circumstances. So these guys, the decision that they made was that they weren't going to worship other gods because that was what they had been told to do, right? The Ten Commandments were given to them. Do not worship other gods, only worship the true God. And so for them to bow down to this would have been disobedient to God. And they chose to follow him despite the circumstances. And I don't know what that looks like for you in your life today, but for each one of us, there are things that we face that we have to make decisions on based on that. The next one I wrote down is this: acknowledge our victories and who gives us our strength. Early in the passage, we saw Daniel acknowledging how he was able to actually interpret the dream. He was able to interpret it, not because he was so wise or something he could do. He did only because that God had given him the answer, and he acknowledged that. The next one I wrote down is this: in the world, we'll see God do amazing things, and we'll see, or other people will see him do amazing things and still fully reject him. Years and years ago, when I was a counselor at Miracle Mountain Ranch, I remember sharing the gospel with a little 8-year-old boy. It still sticks with me today. And I sat down and probably very terribly shared the gospel with this young man. And I just remember him looking at me and I asked him, "So is this something you'd like to do? Would you like to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior?" And he said, "No, I don't want to do that." Have any of you experienced that? I still think of that today, and I think to myself, why? Why would you not want to do that? I don't have an answer. I don't have an answer for that. But that shouldn't stop me from continuing on sharing with people, right? And there's going to be people that are going to see God do amazing things and fully reject him. We can look throughout Scripture and see that. And that shouldn't shock us, and it shouldn't keep us from sharing hope. We should still keep moving forward. Because we saw the king do that, right? Nebuchadnezzar saw what God had done, and he totally rejected him and did his own thing. The last one is this: we need to trust the Lord, even if things do not work out as we think they should. Now, we look at this passage of Scripture and remember, wow, God saved them from that. What an unbelievable miracle. Would God be any different if he hadn't saved them from the fire? No. Still be true. He'd still be who he is, right? And he may not take the circumstances in our lives away that are challenging. And it may be difficult for us, but it doesn't change who God is. God is still in control. And we need to be focused in on just pursuing him with all of our heart. So I hope this is a bit of an encouragement and a challenge at the same time to you. We recognize who our amazing God is and how powerful he is and the things that he can do. And yet sometimes he takes us and allows us to go through certain things to help us grow, to help us be able to show those hope and that stuff through the life that we live. And hopefully that we will be able to see great things happen because of what we learn and how we grow through that. Let's just close in a word of prayer. God, we come to you, acknowledging you as the true God. And Lord, we see you at work in our lives. We see you doing amazing things. And Lord, I pray that we would just stay focused on you. Lord, I pray that we would just be diligent to be in your word, and we'd be growing and just being able to be more effective in the way that we live and the way that we share with others. Lord, thank you for this group of people here meeting at Dunkirk. And we just praise you how that we see joy and excitement here amongst them. Lord, I pray that they would be an amazing light to their community. And they would see young people and adults as well saved and many grow, and that they would just sharpen each other as the days ahead take place. Just thank you again for your incredible love for us, and that you would choose to send your son Jesus to die on the cross for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Greg. What an encouragement this is. Hey, let's close with He is able. He is able, more than able, to accomplish what concerns me today. I think it just fits with what Greg has been talking about. Let's include God in everything we're doing. He's with us. Stand with me and sing this song.
He is able, more than able, to accomplish what concerns me today. Comes my way. He is able, more than able, to do much more than I ever dreamed. He is able, more than able, to make me what He wants me to be.
Let's sing it again.
He is able, more than able, to accomplish what concerns me today. He is able, more than able, to handle anything that comes my way. He is able, more than able, to do much more than I can ever dream.
Heavenly Father, you can do it. We can't, and we need you. Just teach us that more and more, that we need more of you. In Jesus' name, amen.